Hello all, now let's start with antimicrobials which affect the cell membrane of a bacteria. Okay, now the cell membrane inhibitors, we have two types of drugs only. The first drug is daptomycin. Okay, the first drug is daptomycin, and second drug we have is polymyxins. So these are the two classes of drugs which affect the cell membrane of a bacteria. And before starting with the individual drug, remember they both are bactericidal drug. Okay, so they both are bactericidal drugs. So let's see how to remember. Remember, daptomycin is given mainly for all gram positive bacteria as a reserve drug. Okay, all gram positive bacteria as a reserve drug. And polymyxin is given for gram negative bacteria as a reserve drug. Okay, they are used in last resorts. So let's start with the first one, that is daptomycin. Okay, so let's start with the first one, that is daptomycin, then we will discuss polymyxins. Okay, so let's talk about daptomycin. Now, the group of daptomycin is known as, its group is known as lipopeptides. Okay, just for your knowledge, you must write it. Now, what is the mechanism of action of daptomycin? Sir, suppose this is the cell membrane of a bacteria. This daptomycin, it comes and forms micelles. It forms micelles, soap-like effect or detergent like effect on cell membrane. Okay, because of this reason it will create pores. This micelles will create pores. Due to creation of pores, all the ions like sodium, potassium will come inside. The ions will come inside, and ions influx can lead to depolarization. Due to depolarization, excessive depolarization and ion change, the cell becomes dead. It kills the cell by depolarization. Okay, so try to remember, it's a very rapidly acting drug. It kills the bacteria very fast. Now, where it is used, this daptomycin is only given IV. And it is a right now a reserve drug for serious gram positive bacteria. Serious gram positive bacterias. Okay, like it is the drug of choice for VRSA, that is vancomycin resistant staph aureus. Okay, it is also given in VRE, vancomycin resistance enterococci. Vancomycin resistance enterococci. It is also effective in LRSA and LRE, that is linezolid resistant staph aureus and linezolid resistant enterococci, and lastly SRSA, streptogramin resistant staph aureus. Streptogramin is not used in enterococci. Okay, so vancomycin resistant staph aureus and enterococci, linezolid resistant staph aureus and enterococci, and streptogramins resistant staph aureus. Streptogramins are not used in enterococci. Okay, so it is given as a last resort. Okay, last resort. Now let's see what is the side effect. The main side effect of daptomycin is, so daptomycin is not effective in pneumonias. It is not effective in pneumonias caused by this staph aureus and enterococci. The reason is, it degrades by the surfactant which is present in the lung. The surfactant which is present in the lungs neutralizes or degrades it. Hence, in pneumonias, it is not effective. And what is the side effect? The main side effect is, it causes myopathy. Myopathy means muscle pain, and it may also cause neuropathy, neuronal damage. Okay? Myopathy and neuropathy is the side effect of daptomycin. Now, the next group of antimicrobial we have is polymyxins. okay, polymyxins. Now, polymyxins, you will write, we have various polymyxin known as polymyxin B. This is the first drug. Similarly, we have polymyxin E. Polymyxin E. Remember, this polymyxin E is also known as colistin. It is also known as colistin. Okay. Now, where these drugs are used, these drugs are given only for gram negative bacteria. Now, which gram negative bacteria? You will write four. You'll write PIC. It is given against Pseudomonas. You'll write Acinetobacter. You'll write Klebsiella and E. coli. Now, they are not the drug of choice. Remember, they are the drug of choice in MDR species. MDR means multi drug resistant species. Multi drug resistant species of these bacteria. Now, remember, generally for these bacteria, as a last resort, we use a drug carbapenems. Carbapenems is generally given as the last drug. If the drug is resistant to carbapenem, these bacteria are known as MDR bacteria. Because of this reason, if carbapenem resistant cases, we give colistin. Colistin. How we give? IV. We give IV colistin. Okay. That is why colistin like drug, they are known as drug of last resort. They are known as drug of last resort. Routinely, they are not used. Why routinely they are not used? Routinely, they are not used because they are highly toxic drug. So routinely, you will write, these drugs, IV drugs, are not used because they are highly toxic. Their action is, they are highly neurotoxic and they are highly nephrotoxic. They are highly neurotoxic. They are highly nephrotoxic. So routinely they are not used. But remember, they are used routinely in cases as a topical drug on skin. Okay. They can be given topical drug on skin for gram negative infection. And it comes with a very famous cream, a very famous brand name known as Neosporin cream. It comes in a very famous brand name, Neosporin cream. Neosporin cream contains three chemical, which is a topical skin cream. It contains polymyxin. It contains one aminoglycoside, neomycin, which these two drugs will cover gram negative bacteria, and bacitracin. Bacitracin generally covers gram positive bacteria. They cover gram negative bacteria. It comes in a very famous brand cream, Neosporin. But are they given IV? Yes, they are given IV only in the last resort, when the patient is going to die, because they are highly neurotoxic and nephrotoxic drug. So they are given as a last resort for MDR species of Pseudomonas, Acinetobacter, Klebsiella and E. coli. Okay, gram negative bacteria. So these are the examples of polymyxins. So what is the action of polymyxins? Same like daptomycin. Their mechanism of action is same like daptomycin. They also go to the cell membrane and they have detergent like action, and they also create pores. So same action like daptomycin. Okay, and remember, they are bactericidal. So this is all about cell wall inhibitors. Thank you very much. Hello all, now let's start with the antimicrobials which inhibit certain metabolic reactions. Those metabolic reaction, one of the metabolic reaction is synthesis of folic acid in a bacteria. Okay, now remember, folic acid in a microbe is an essential component. It is required for synthesizing various products. Now let's see how folic acid is synthesized in a bacteria. Suppose this is a bacteria. Bacteria acquires a molecule from outside known as PABA. It acquires this molecule from the outside. PABA stands for para amino benzoic acid. Okay, so it is known as para amino benzoic acid. Now this para amino benzoic acid, it is present in necrotic cells. When a cell becomes dead, the folic acid present in the cell becomes degraded into PABA, or it is present in abscess, or it is present in pus like situation. Okay, it contains various lot of PABA. Now the point is, when PABA is acquired by the bacteria, it enters into the bacteria, and with the help of two molecules known as pteridine and lastly you will write glutamate, one amino acid, this bacteria synthesizes folic acid. Okay, folic acid is synthesized. To synthesize this folic acid, bacteria requires an enzyme known as folate synthase. Okay, the enzyme required is folate synthase. So folic acid is synthesized by three molecules. This enzyme is also known as dihydroterate synthase. Okay, this enzyme is also known as dihydroterate synthase. Now this folic acid, when it is synthesized, remember this folic acid right now is not the active form. The active form of folic acid is known as tetrahydrofolate. Okay, tetrahydrofolate means with this folic acid four molecules of hydrogens are attached, known as tetrahydrofolate, because this tetrahydrofolate can synthesize various molecules. Okay, it can take part in chemical reaction. To synthesize this tetrahydrofolate, the bacteria acquires an enzyme known as DHFR enzyme. DHFR stands for dihydrofolate reductase enzyme. Okay, dihydrofolate reductase enzyme. Remember, we humans cannot synthesize folic acid from outside. We need folic acid from outside. We ourselves cannot synthesize folic acid. We lack this enzyme folate synthase. But in humans, we have this dihydrofolate reductase enzyme. Okay, in humans we have DHFR enzyme, we don't have folate, but bacteria and other microbes, it has both of this enzyme. Now this tetrahydrofolate can synthesize various molecules. It can take part in chemical reaction. It can form thymidine. Okay, thymidine with the help of thymidylate synthase enzyme, which can take part in synthesis of DNA. It synthesizes various purines and pyrimidines. Okay, so it acts as a cofactor through which again DNA and RNA are synthesized. This tetrahydrofolate is required for synthesis of one amino acid known as methionine. And when methionine will join, it is required in synthesis of proteins as well. So this tetrahydrofolate has various uses in the body that will be discussed later on. Now let's talk about certain antimicrobial. The first antimicrobial which inhibit folate synthase enzyme in a bacteria, that antimicrobial is known as sulfonamides. Okay, sulfonamides, they inhibit folate synthase enzyme. Most of these sulfonamide we will be discussing, they will be starting with the word sulfa. But there are certain exceptions. You will write, there is one drug known as Dapsone, which is an anti-leprosy drug. It is also a sulfonamide. Okay, and one first anti-tubercular drug known as PAS, para-aminosalicylic acid, it is also a sulfonamide. Okay, so these are the examples of sulfonamide. Now the drug which inhibit DHFR enzyme are, you'll write trimethoprim inhibit DHFR enzyme, and it mainly inhibit DHFR enzyme in bacteria and some protozoans as well. Then we have a drug known as pyrimethamine and proguanil. This pyrimethamine and proguanil predominantly inhibit DHFR enzyme in protozoa. Okay, they also have a little bit antibacterial action, but they are mainly given for protozoan infection. So trimethoprim you can remember predominantly in bacteria, little bit in protozoa also, and pyrimethamine and proguanil, they inhibit DHFR enzyme in protozoa. Just for your information, there is one drug known as methotrexate. Methotrexate inhibit this DHFR enzyme in humans. Because of this reason, methotrexate is not used as an antimicrobial, it is rather used as an anti-cancer drug to kill human cell, because it will inhibit DNA synthesis. Okay, DNA replication will not occur and the cell will die. So methotrexate is used in human. So methotrexate we will be discussing in anti-cancer drug. So in antimicrobial, you have to remember these drugs. Okay, they have predominant action on bacteria and protozoa, but they little bit inhibit in humans also, because human they have DHFR enzyme. Now you just have to remember one point: whenever you are giving these drugs, trimethoprim, pyrimethamine and methotrexate, remember with these drugs their antidote or one drug you have to add, because these drugs they have a common side effect, they can cause folic acid deficiency in human. These drugs can cause folic acid deficiency in humans as well. To treat this folic acid deficiency, all these drugs, trimethoprim, pyrimethamine, proguanil and methotrexate, they should be given with folinic acid. We always give folinic acid with them. Now what is folinic acid? Folinic acid is different from folic acid. If you will give folic acid from outside, as DHFR enzyme is inhibited, this folic acid will not be converted into tetrahydrofolate. What is folinic acid? Folinic acid is a modified form of tetrahydrofolate only. Okay, it is a modified form of tetrahydrofolate. Tetrahydrofolate, which is sometimes known as formal tetrahydrofolate. So when you are giving any drug which is inhibiting DHFR enzyme, you have to give folinic acid, whether it is trimethoprim, pyrimethamine, proguanil and methotrexate. Okay, folinic acid. Just remember, another name of folinic acid is, folinic acid is also known as citrovorum factor. Okay, it is also known as citrovorum factor, and it comes with a brand name known as leucovorin. These are the two other names of folinic acid. Okay, try to remember them. Okay, citrovorum factor and leucovorin. Now let's come to the properties of these drugs. Okay, properties of these drugs. You will write that whether it is sulfonamide and whether it is other drug like trimethoprim, pyrimethamine and proguanil. Sir, all these drugs are bacteriostatic drug. They all are bacteriostatic drugs. Okay, so individually remember they are bacteriostatic drug, but remember their combination, if you will combine them, which combination you will write sulfonamide with any of this drug, their combination is bactericidal. So combination of sulfonamide with either trimethoprim, pyrimethamine is bactericidal combination. Why? Because they are causing sequential blockage. They are acting in the same sequence. They may lead to complete deficiency of folic acid and the bacteria or antimicrobial, the microbe will die easily. Okay, because of which property? They act in a sequence. Hence the combination of trimethoprim with sulfonamide, pyrimethamine with sulfonamide is a bactericidal combination. Individually they are bacteriostatic. Okay, individually they are bacteriostatic. So keep this thing in mind. Let's start with the first drug, that is sulfonamides. Okay, sulfonamides. Okay, so let's repeat, what is the mechanism of action of sulfonamide? Remember, sulfonamide, they are structural analog. Their structure is similar to PABA, para-aminobenzoic acid, and because of this reason they competitively inhibit which enzyme? Folate synthase enzyme. They competitively inhibit folate synthase enzyme, so they will compete with PABA. Now you have to remember one point, that if the level of normal PABA is very high, Sulfonamides will lose the competition and PABA will not be inhibited. And we know that PABA is very much present in abscess or pus-like situation. In abscess or pus, there is very high amount of PABA. Because PABA is nothing, it is the degrading product of folic acid. It contains very high amount of PABA and sulfonamide, they cannot competitively win with PABA in that case. Hence, in abscess or pus-like situation, you will write sulfonamides are not effective. If an infection is causing abscess or pus, sulfonamides are not effective. The reason is they contain very high amount of PABA PABA. Okay, so remember, so as they are competitively inhibiting folate synthase enzyme, they are also sometimes known as anti-metabolites. Because they are inhibiting metabolic reaction, sulfonamides, trimethoprim, pyrimethamine, they are also known as anti-metabolites. Because they are just structural analog of a metabolite, PABA. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have among sulfonamides. Okay, drugs. So first we will write certain systemic drugs. Systemic drug means that these drugs are given oral or IV. Oral or IV. You write the first drug, that is sulfadoxine. This sulfadoxine overall is the longest acting drug. Okay, longest acting. And where it is used, if you will combine this sulfadoxine with pyrimethamine, can we say that this combination will become bactericidal combination? And pyrimethamine is mainly effective against protozoa. This combination is the drug of choice for the treatment of malaria. Okay, this combination is given in the treatment of malaria with a drug known as artisonate. With a drug known as artisonate. So artisonate is combined with sulfadoxine pyrimethamine combination. And this combination is the most commonly used combination for the treatment of malaria in India. Okay. And this sulfadoxine is overall the most longest acting drug. Now let's talk about other drug. You will write sulfadiazine. Plus pyrimethamine again. Sulfadiazine plus pyrimethamine, it is used in the treatment of one protozoa known as Toxoplasma. Toxoplasma gondii. Okay, so this is the drug of choice for the treatment of Toxoplasma gondii infection. Now let's see how to treat toxoplasmosis. In toxoplasmosis, we start with sulfadiazine plus pyrimethamine. In not responsive cases, you will write that we add a drug clindamycin. We add a drug, clindamycin. So try to remember. So in non-responsive case, we add clindamycin. But remember, these drugs, sulfadiazine and pyrimethamine, they should not be given in pregnancy. Because they are folic acid inhibitor, don't you think they will cause folic acid deficiency in pregnancy, which could be dangerous? So in pregnancy, the drug of choice for toxoplasmosis is one macrolide known as spiramycin. The treatment of toxoplasmosis in pregnancy is spiramycin, because spiramycin is safe in pregnancy. Okay, safe in pregnancy. Now let's move forward. The third drug we have, you'll write sulfamethoxazole, and it is combined with trimethoprim. Again, it is a bactericidal combination, and this combination is known as co means combine, trim, from where this trim word has taken, we have taken from here, oxazole. Okay, oxazole we have taken from here. So this combination is known as co-trimoxazole, and in which where a combination we combine them, you will write 5:1. We combine them in 5:1, 5 times sulfamethoxazole and 1 time trimethoprim. So let's write few points about co-trimoxazole. So cotrimoxazole, remember, it's a bactericidal combination. It's a bactericidal combination. Why? Because of sequential blockage. In which combination we combine? Sulfamethoxazole and trimethoprim, they are combined in the ratio 5:1. Okay? They are combined in the ratio 5:1. And when they enter into the bacteria, their concentration which is achieved inside the bacteria, intracellular concentration which becomes is 20:1. Okay, 20, because sulfamethoxazole can easily penetrate a bacterial cell membrane. So intracellular, this is the drug concentration we give. This is the drug concentration we formulate. And inside the bacteria, the concentration which is achieved is 20:1. Okay, so and it's a bactericidal combination. So keep this thing in mind. Let's see what are the uses of cotrimoxazole. It's a very important point, you must remember. So you can write one mnemonic, uses of cotrimoxazole. Mnemonic is pint, okay, beer cup. Okay, pint, beer cup. So you will write, cotrimoxazole is the drug of choice for pneumocystis jeroveci infection, which is a very common infection in HIV/AIDS patient, which causes pneumonia. It is also the drug of choice for Isospora. Isospora, again, a common opportunistic infection in HIV. The third common opportunistic infection in HIV is Nocardia. It is the drug of choice for Nocardia. It can be given in typhoid carriers. Before you will write, it is given in cases of Burkholderia species. Burkholderia species like Burkholderia capacica. And you can write Burkholderia pseudomallei. Now C for you will write Cyclospora. You will write, it can be given as a broad spectrum drug in cases of UTI and cystitis. And it can be given as a broad spectrum drug in cases of prostatitis. Okay. So these are the drugs. These are the uses of pneumocystis jeroveci infection. Okay. So it's a very important drug. Now let's write about other sulfonamides. Other sulfonamides you can write. The fourth one is sulfisoxazole. You'll write sulfisoxazole is most soluble in urine. Okay, most soluble in urine. Because of this reason, it has least chance to precipitate. In urine. So this tells us one point, that sulfonamide gets precipitated out in urine. And when they precipitate out in urine, they cause least chance of crystallurea. So sulfonamides, they cause crystallurea, and minimum crystallurea because of most soluble is sulfisoxazole. So SO word is coming, you can remember. So it causes least crystallurea. Okay, and the last point you can write, sulfacetin. Sulfacetin is overall the shortest acting sulfonamide. Just for your reference, you have to write, it is the shortest acting sulfonamide. Okay, so these are the systemic sulfonamides. Now let's talk about certain topical sulfonamides. Okay, the first topical sulfonamide you will write is silver sulfadiazine and sulfacetamide. They are given as a topical eye drops. In cases of ophthalmia, neonatorum. Okay, and this silver sulfadiazine is more preferred because it contains silver. Remember, silver has also antifungal activity. Silver has also antifungal activity as well. Second point you will write, silver sulfadiazine again. And second drug you will write, mefenide. They are given as a skin cream in cases of burns patient. In cases of burns patient. Because if the skin is damaged, infection can go very easily inside. Again here, the more preferred drug is silver sulfadiazine. It is given as a 1% eye drops or skin. The solution of silver sulfadiazine is 1%. Okay, mefenide is less preferred because mefenide sometimes get absorbed into the skin and it may cause lactic acidosis. And in burns patient, already due to stress and anaerobic respiration, there is already lactic acidosis, so it is less preferred. Silver sulfadiazine is more preferred. Okay, so silver sulfadiazine, remember, it has a very good activity on skin for killing Staph aureus infection. Staph aureus. Okay, Staph aureus. And it is given as a 1% cream for the burns patient. Remember, these drugs should be avoided generally in pregnancy. In pregnancy, they should be avoided. Okay, because they are teratogenic, they cause folic acid deficiency. So these are the certain topical drugs. Now let's talk about certain sulfonamides which are given in GIT, but they are not absorbed. They are given in GIT. The classical example is sulfasalazine. Now, sulfasalazine go to our large intestine or colon, and in colon there are bacterias. This bacteria split this or degrade sulfadiazine into two molecules, that is sulfapyridine and 5-ASA. So this is broken down by the bacteria present in large intestine. 5-ASA stand for 5-amino salicylic acid. Now what happens, this 5-ASA cannot be absorbed, it remains here, while sulfapyridine goes into the blood. Sulfapyridine goes into the blood. Now remember, these two molecules, when they are combined, it is known as sulfasalazine, and they are combined with a bond known as azo bond. So this azo bond is broken down by the bacteria. So bacteria, it breaks down this azo bond between these two molecules. These two moiety becomes separated. This sulfapyridine which comes into the blood, remember, it is used in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. Why? Because it has immunosuppressive effect. It suppresses the immunity of the body. And 5-ASA remains there in colon, and it is used in the treatment of one autoimmune or inflammatory condition known as ulcerative colitis. It is used in the treatment of ulcerative colitis. Okay, so this sulfasalazine is a sulfonamide, and it is used in GIT condition like ulcerative colitis. Because of 5-ASA moiety, it will remain here, and sulfapyridine comes into the blood and causes rheumatoid arthritis. Now this sulfapyridine, its side effect is it causes bone marrow suppression and it decreases sperm count. Because of this reason, for the treatment of ulcerative colitis, we have made certain new drugs which do not contain sulfapyridine, which only contain 5-ASA, so that these unwanted side effect of sulfapyridine will not come. So we have made new drug like olsalazine. Olsalazine contains only 5-ASA linked to 5-ASA through azo bond. Which bond? Azo bond, 5-ASA. Okay, you'll write balsalazide. So it does not contain any sulfapyridine. Balsalazide. Balsalazide also contains 5-ASA with some proteins. And you can write mesalazine. Mesalazine is also known as mesalamine. because mesalazine, it only contains 5-ASA. Okay, and this 5-ASA is pH and time release preparation, which we will be discussing in ulcerative colitis. So these are the modification of sulfasalazine or sulfonamide used in, okay, ulcerative colitis. Now let's talk about the pharmacokinetics of sulfonamide. Remember, sulfonamides, they are metabolized by a process. They are degraded in the body by a process known as acetylation. Okay? And I told you which drugs they get metabolized by acetylation. The name of those drug was ship drugs. So it's a part of ship drug. S for sulfonamide, H for hydralazine, I for isoniazid, and P for procainamide. These are drugs which get metabolized by in our body by acetylation. And remember, in slow acetylators, most of Indians are slow acetylators, all these ship drugs, they causes a common side effect in slow acetylator, because sulfonamide will get accumulated, they cause DLE. DLE stand for drug induced SLE. So all ship drug in slow acetylator causes drug induced SLE. So try to remember. Now let's talk about side effects. Now remember, any drug that contains sulfa, remember, causes severe allergic reactions. Sulfa is allergic to us. Okay, so try to remember, keep this thing in mind. Let's see what are the side effects. You'll write, the side effects are rash, ABC. Okay, so first side effect is rashes, which is also known as fixed drug eruption. Overall, rashes is the most common side effect of sulfonamide. The most common side effect of sulfonamide is rashes. Okay, second point, you know, they cause aplastic anemia, a very dangerous reaction, allergic reaction, which can lead to bone marrow suppression. Okay, they cause SLE or DLE, and you know, in slow acetylator, they cause SLE or DLE. They cause hemolysis in G6PD deficient individuals. Okay, G6PD deficient people. A for, you will write, they suppress bone marrow and they may cause agranulocytosis. The neutrophilic count decreases or a granulocytosis will not happen. And sir, they increase bilirubin level. Why they increase bilirubin level? Because they displace bilirubin from albumin. Because of this reason, sulfonamides, they are absolutely contraindicated in neonates. Because in neonates, when bilirubin will become free, this bilirubin in neonate, it can cross blood-brain barrier. Because blood-brain barrier in neonates is not fully developed, it can lead to kernicterus. Bilirubin can damage neurons of brain. So why sulfonamides are contraindicated in neonates? Because they cause a side effect known as kernicterus. Because what is kernicterus? The bilirubin will become free. Okay? Bilirubin will become free. Remember, there are two antimicrobials which are contraindicated in neonate. One is sulfonamide because they cause kernicterus. Second, you will write, chloramphenicol is also contraindicated in neonates. Chloramphenicol is also contraindicated in neonate because chloramphenicol causes a side effect known as gray baby syndrome. It causes a side effect known as gray baby syndrome. So remember, two antimicrobials which are contraindicated in neonate as well as preterm infants also is sulfonamide and chloramphenicol. Sulfonamide, they cause kernicterus. Try to remember, they displace bilirubin. Bilirubin will enter into the brain and cause neuronal damage. This is known as kernicterus. And chloramphenicol, gray baby syndrome. And last point is, they cause crystallurea in urine. They cause crystallurea. Their crystals get precipitated out in urine. In which urine? You will write acidic urine. In acidic urine, their crystal precipitates. Okay, so this is all about sulfonamides. Now let's talk about certain antimicrobials or other drugs which are contraindicated in G6PD deficiency. The drugs which are contraindicated in G6PD deficiency. Now, why these drugs are contraindicated in G6PD deficiency? Remember, first let's understand why they are contraindicated. G6PD is an enzyme known as glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme. Now, this enzyme is an enzyme of HMP pathway. HMP is hexose monophosphate pathway, which is required for formation of ATP. And this pathway is exclusively present in RBC. This enzyme is present in RBC and this enzyme is required for synthesis of ATP. Now, when this glucose enters into RBC, the first enzyme which function is G6PD enzyme. And this is G6PD enzyme generate a molecule known as NADPH. It generates a molecule known as NADPH. So NADPH molecule is synthesized from this G6PD enzyme. And this NADPH enzyme is required for synthesis of one antioxidant known as glutathione. So glutathione is protective for RBC. Okay, glutathione, let's write it as GSH. Otherwise, glutathione, remember, remains in an oxidized form linked among themselves. So this is the active form of glutathione, GSH. So this H is given by NADPH. Now, in cases of G6PD enzyme deficiency, remember, there is glutathione deficiency. There is glutathione deficiency. Because of this reason, this antioxidant property is lacking. Now, the point is, any drug which forms oxidative radicals, remember, they are contraindicated in G6PD enzyme deficiency, because this glutathione enzyme is not there and the oxidative free radicals will accumulate in RBC, and this oxidative free radical damage cell membrane of RBC. And if the cell membrane of RBC gets damaged, it leads to hemolysis. Now, keeping this thing in mind, let's see what are the drugs which are generally contraindicated in G6PD enzyme deficiency. And these drugs form oxidative radical. So you can write the list of the drugs. The first is antimicrobials. Okay. The first drug you will write is antimicrobial. Now, which antimicrobials are contraindicated in G6PD enzyme deficiency? You will write one mnemonic, fluoroscan. Okay, sorry, fluoroscan. The first is fluoroquinolones. Second, you will write sulfonamides. And you will write not trimethoprim. Not trimethoprim. Then you will write chloramphenicol. You will write antimalarial. Antimalarial, you will write maximum is with Primaquine. You'll write quinine and proguanil. You'll write minimum is with chloroquine. So chloroquine can be given, but it's still unsafe. And the most safest antimalarial in G6PD enzyme deficiency is mefloquine. Mefloquine is considered the most safest one. But among them, chloroquine is one of the drug which is safe, which you have to remember. Okay, chloroquine. Now let's move forward. N for nitroimidazole. Now, nitroimidazole, remember they contain a drug metronidazole. Okay, and you can write nitrofurantoin because they form nitric oxide free radical. So these drugs, they are contraindicated in G6PD enzyme deficiency. Okay, so they are contraindicated in G6PD enzyme deficiency. Now remember, penicillins are safe. You'll write penicillins or beta lactams, they are safe in G6PD enzyme deficiency. They are safe in G6PD enzyme deficiency. So try to remember. Now let's write other drugs. You can write enthelminthics, second class of drug, which are contraindicated in G6PD enzyme deficiency. You can write nerida-zole. Nerida-zole is contraindicated in G6PD enzyme deficiency. Then you write certain dyes like methylene blue. Methylene blue is a dye which was earlier used as an antimicrobial agent. Now it is contraindicated. Certain food like fava beans. Fava beans is absolutely contraindicated in G6PD enzyme deficiency. You'll write anti-cancer drug like you'll write doxorubicin and ruspuricase. They are absolutely contraindicated. Okay, absolutely contraindicated. So they are the most unsafe drug in cases of G6PD enzyme deficiency. Now let's come to DHFR inhibitors. So the first DHFR inhibitor we will discuss is trimethoprim. Okay, dihydrofolate reductase inhibitor. So the drug name is trimethoprim. Okay, trimethoprim. Now we know that trimethoprim, it inhibits dihydrofolate reductase enzyme. Now we know it is combined with sulfonamide, and that combination was known as cotrimoxazole. So the combination was known as cotrimoxazole with sulfonamide, and that was a bactericidal combination. But alone, where trimethoprim is used, alone trimethoprim can be used in prostatitis, because it is secreted in prostatic acid secretion. But remember, the drug of choice for prostatitis is fluoroquinolones. Fluoroquinolones is considered as the most effective drug for prostatitis. Okay, so try to remember. Now second point is, let's talk about its side effect. Now trimethoprim causes folic acid deficiency, and folic acid deficiency causes pancytopenia. All cell lines, RBC, WBC and platelet, will decrease, and RBC will become big. They cause megaloblastic anemia. Okay, megaloblastic anemia. Second point with trimethoprim is, trimethoprim inhibit aldosterone. It blocks aldosterone receptor in kidney. Remember, in kidney, aldosterone forms one protein known as ENaC proteins. So it inhibit ENaC. Because of this reason, sodium gets excreted out in urine while potassium is retained, so they cause hyperkalemia. So they produce effect just like potassium sparing diuretic. Okay, so trimethoprim can cause hyperkalemia. Just like an ENaC inhibitor diuretic, you must have learned that is amiloride, triamterene, etc. They also cause hyperkalemia. Now any drug that blocks aldosterone receptor in kidney, which inhibits the action of aldosterone, it causes one disease which presents as hyperkalemia. That disease is known as RTA type 4. RTA type 4 stands for renal tubular acidosis. So what is the list of the drugs that causes renal tubular acidosis? You can write one mnemonic, Natak Panti. Okay, So you'll write NSAIDs, they also inhibit this aldosterone action, ACE inhibitors or ARB, trimethoprim, okay? You'll write potassium sparing diuretics like spironolactone, amiloride, etc. Because aldosterone is required for sodium retention and potassium excretion, and P for an antimicrobial drug, pentamidine. Okay, pentamidine. So try to remember, these drugs, they cause hyperkalemia. Hyperkalemia, renal tubular acidosis type 4. Okay, so this completes your the drugs which inhibit folate metabolism. So thank you very much for listening.